Thank you, colleagues. We're going to move on to the next item of business, which is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon, the First Minister, on COVID-19. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement. I would encourage members who wish to ask a question to press their buttons, and I call on the First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will update Parliament today on some changes to the lockdown restrictions currently in place across most of Scotland. These changes relate to outdoor meetings and activities. I'll also announce a change which I hope will be welcomed by Scotland's faith communities. Now, while the changes I set out today are relatively minor, they are important for our well-being, and they do represent gradual, but I hope steady, steps out of lockdown and back towards a life where we can all interact much more freely with our loved ones. Next week, I will set out a firmer indicative timetable for reopening the economy, including shops, hospitality, hairdressers, gyms, and parts of our tourism sector. Presiding Officer, the ability to announce even limited changes at this stage is possible only because of the hard sacrifices that the majority of people across the country continue to make each and every single day. So let me at the outset acknowledge and be clear that I share the anger and despair that the vast majority of people, including I'm sure the majority of football fans, felt at the weekend towards crowds of supporters flagrantly breaching rules that the rest of us are following every day at great personal cost. The behaviour witnessed at the weekend was disgraceful and it was selfish. Now, it's natural that some of the anger people feel is directed towards the government and the police. I absolutely understand that. All of us must reflect on what more could have been done and what more we need to do to avoid any repeat in the future. But those at fault are those who breached the rules. How the police manage situations like this is, of course, an operational matter. Government cannot and should not direct policing operations. I will, though, be speaking to the Chief Constable later this afternoon to consider what further action might be necessary to avoid any repeat of the unacceptable scenes we saw at the weekend. However, no one should doubt the deeply invidious situation that behaviour like this puts the police in as they discharge their responsibility to protect public order and public safety. We'll also be having further discussions this week with the football authorities and with certain football clubs who, in my view, do need to show much more leadership on occasions like this. Now, let me be clear. In making these comments, I really don't care about the colour of the shirt. My comments on these matters are in no way partisan. I said some harsh things about Celtic's decisions at the start of this year. And as far as I'm concerned, in this case, Rangers Football Club could have done more to help avoid this situation arising at the weekend. The fact is that elite sport is being allowed to continue just now so that fans, deprived like all of us of so much else in life right now, can continue to watch and support their teams. It would be deeply unfair if a minority spoiled that for the majority, and I very much hope that will not be the case. But given the fragility of the situation we face right now, we cannot simply turn a blind eye to what happened at the weekend, and we won't. So we will report back in due course and certainly ahead of the Old Firm match scheduled for the 21st of March on the various discussions taking place this week. Now, finally, on this subject, I completely understand why people watching what unfolded at the weekend might wonder why they are bothering doing the right thing. But the fact is, the vast majority of us are doing the right thing because we know it really matters. It matters for our own health and for the health of our loved ones. It is about saving lives and it is working. As I will set out shortly, we are firmly on the right path. So no matter how legitimately angry we feel, let's not allow the irresponsible behaviour of a minority to set us all back. Let's stick with it as we make our way slowly but surely back to normality. Let me turn then to the substance of today's statement with an overview of the latest statistics and the state of the epidemic and then the detail of the initial changes that we are proposing. Firstly, today's statistics, the total number of positive cases reported yesterday was 466. That is 3.3% of all tests carried out and takes the total number of cases now to 206,465. 614 people are in hospital, 40 fewer than yesterday, and 50 people are receiving intensive care, 9 fewer than yesterday. However, I regret to report that in the past 24 hours, a further 19 deaths have been registered of patients who first tested positive over the previous 28 days, and the total number of deaths under this measurement is therefore now 7,441. And yet again, I want to send my deepest condolences to all those who have lost a loved one. Now, a week ago yesterday was the anniversary of the first confirmed COVID case in Scotland. This Saturday coming will be the anniversary of the first confirmed death in Scotland of someone with COVID. And then in 2 weeks' time, on 23rd March, we will reach the first anniversary of lockdown. The Scottish Government has been in contact with a number of organisations to discuss how we can best mark that day. And on 22nd March, I will meet representatives of UK COVID Families for Justice. Current plans for the 23rd of March include a national silence. We're also discussing how communities can be supported to develop their own commemorative activities over the coming year as part of longer-term plans for remembrance. And I will set out more detail of all of this over the next fortnight. In addition, I know Parliament will wish to consider how it marks the occasion. And all of us, I'm sure, will want to remember all those who have been lost over the past year and to offer our continued thoughts, solidarity and support to the bereaved. Presiding Officer, the figures I've just reported for new cases, people in hospital and, of course, deaths are still higher than we would want them to be. But they are not as high as they were just a few weeks ago, and so I think it is worth reflecting on the positive trend that we are now seeing. 2 weeks ago, we were recording an average of 815 new cases a day across the country. Last week, that had fallen to 657 new cases a day. And this week, it has fallen further to an average of 490 new cases a day. The average test positivity rate is now just above 3%. Admissions to hospitals and intensive care units are also falling. And the number of deaths, although still heartbreakingly high, has almost halved since the third week of January. We're also continuing to make excellent progress with the vaccination programme. As of 8:30 this morning, 1,789,377 people in Scotland have received the first dose of vaccine. That's an increase of 14,718 since yesterday. Now, the number of vaccines being administered each day has fallen during the last week or so. That's because of a dip in supply that I had spoken about previously and which we have been expecting and planning for. But from around the middle of this month onwards, we expect supplies to pick up again and for that to allow for a very significant acceleration in the vaccination programme. It is worth noting that some of these supplies will be of short-dated stock. In other words, they will be of vaccines that must be used very soon after they have been received. Now, at the moment, the vaccination programme is working through priority groups 6 and 7, which includes 60 to 64-year-olds, unpaid carers and people with particular underlying health conditions. For example, unpaid carers who are not registered with the Scottish Social Services Council will be able to self-register for vaccination from next Monday onwards. However, I can confirm that we are now in a position to start scheduling appointments for people in groups 8 and 9, that is people who are 55 to 59 years old and people who are 50 to 54 years old. I should point out, of course, that many in these age groups, 30% of 50 to 54-year-olds and 36% of 55 to 59-year-olds, have already had the first dose due to having an underlying health condition. However, by now scheduling appointments for these age groups, generally, we can ensure that no vaccine goes to waste and that we can meet our target of offering first doses to everyone on the initial JCVI priority list. That's everyone over 50, all unpaid carers and all adults with an underlying health condition by mid-April. Now, the good progress we are making on vaccination is, of course, important context for today's statement. Almost 40% of the entire adult population has now received a first dose of the vaccine. There's already strong evidence that the vaccination programme has significantly reduced deaths in care homes, and studies are also starting to show that vaccination, as well as reducing illness and death, can significantly reduce transmission of the virus. We therefore have not absolute confidence yet, but increasing confidence that as more and more people acquire some protection through vaccination, we will be able to ease restrictions while still keeping the R number below one. In addition to vaccine protection, continued international travel restrictions and the work of test and protect will help us keep the virus under control as we hopefully return to much greater normality in our everyday lives. So the prospects are now very encouraging indeed. That said though, getting the timing of all of this right remains essential. If our easing of restrictions gets ahead of our progress on vaccination, the virus will run out of control again. That's what we must avoid, and that is why, notwithstanding all the positive news, caution is still essential at this stage. Case numbers, while much lower than at the start of the year, are still high, and although we are confident that the R number is currently below one, it's probably not very far below one. We also know that the more transmissible variant of COVID, which was identified before Christmas, now accounts for almost 90% of all new cases in Scotland. And we have no real experience yet of just how far and fast that variant will spread as we start to emerge from lockdown. Indeed, it's possible that some of the very significant steps we're already taking to get children back to school could push the R number back above one. And if that happens, as we know all too well, case numbers will start to grow again. And even though older people who are more likely to die from the virus now have stronger protection as a result of the vaccine, no vaccine will provide absolute protection for our most vulnerable citizens. In addition, we know the virus can cause significant long-term harm to people of all ages. People in their 30s, 40s and 50s make up a significant proportion of those who are currently in hospital with COVID. And of course, there are people who have never been in hospital but who are still suffering from what is known as long COVID. In addition, if we allow more people to get the virus, we also increase the risk of new variants emerging. And finally, we also need to show continued caution about the risk of new variants entering the country. A possible, although still unconfirmed, further case of the P1 Brazil variant in Scotland has now been identified. It involves an individual who travelled to Scotland from Rio de Janeiro via Paris and arrived on the 19th of February. The individual followed all the procedures for managed self-isolation, and we currently have no reason to believe that this case presents any risk to the wider community. However, we are, of course, continuing to undertake all necessary follow-up work. The point I'm making, Presiding Officer, is that even though we are heading firmly in the right direction right now, and I firmly believe we are, we cannot afford to take our foot off the brake too soon. We still need to keep the virus under control if our hopes for a much more normal summer are not to suffer a setback. And if we continue to prioritise children's education, as I believe we should and indeed must, our scope to make further changes will be limited while we are still rolling out the vaccine. We do, of course, intend to ease restrictions as soon as we safely can, and we will do it quicker than previously anticipated if that proves to be possible. And as I indicated earlier, when I update Parliament next week, I will set out a firmer timeline for our exit from lockdown. Today, however, I want to set out some changes that we believe can be made safely more immediately. In considering this, we have very deliberately prioritised changes which might improve our general well-being and quality of life without having too big an impact on infection rates. And we focused in particular on restoring a bit more normality for children. The first set of changes relates to outdoor social interactions. We realise that meeting up, even outdoors, even in Scotland, can be hugely beneficial for our well-being. So from Friday, we intend to relax the law so that up to 4 adults from up to 2 households will be able to meet outdoors. And in addition, we will make clear in the guidance that this will allow for social and recreational purposes as well as essential exercise. Meeting will be possible in any outdoor space, including private gardens. But please do stick to the new rules. Gatherings must be a maximum of 4 people from 2 households, and you should only go indoors if that is essential in order to reach a back garden or to use a toilet. And for now, please stay as close to home as possible. We hope to be in a position to relax, at least to some extent, travel restrictions within Scotland in the weeks ahead, but our advice is that it would not be safe to do so quite yet. For young people aged 12 to 17, we want to be even more flexible to enable more interaction with friends. So for 12 to 17-year-olds, outdoor meetings will also be limited to a maximum of 4 people, but the 2-household limit won't apply. That means four friends from four different families will be able to get together outdoors, and this will hopefully allow young people to see more of their friends than is currently the case. We're also proposing some changes to the rules on outdoor exercise and activities. From Friday, outdoor non-contact sports and organised group exercise will be permitted for all adults in groups of up to 15 people. We will also ensure that there is some flexibility around the travel rules for young people so that children are not prevented from taking part in sport if, for example, they belong to a club that is a bit outside their own local authority area. Now, these are minor changes, I know that, but I do think they are important changes. They have also been made possible by the hard sacrifices the majority of people across the country have made, and we will seek to build on them as quickly as possible in the weeks ahead. The other careful change that we feel able to make at this stage relates to places of worship. I can confirm that, assuming no deterioration in the situation with the virus between now and then, we intend to allow communal worship to restart from Friday, 26 March. This is in time for Passover, Easter, Ramadan and Vaisakhi. In addition, the limit on attendance at communal services will be increased from 20, which was the limit in place before lockdown, to 50, assuming, of course, that a place of worship is spacious enough to accommodate that many people with 2 metre physical distancing. Now, I know that the restrictions on communal worship have been really difficult for many people, despite the quite exceptional efforts made by faith groups to reach out to their communities. This change, again, is relatively minor. It is proportionate, and we believe that it can be achieved relatively safely, but it will hopefully enable more people to draw strength, comfort and inspiration from acts of collective worship. Presiding Officer, all of us, I think, can see that things are getting better just now. In recent weeks, we have seen a significant fall in new cases. Deaths and hospital admissions are thankfully now falling, and the vaccination programme is not just progressing well, it is progressing beyond our initial expectations. All of this is excellent news and it provides really strong grounds for hope. But that hope must also be balanced by caution. Because we have been in lockdown, it's easy to overlook the fact that the virus we are dealing with now is much more infectious than the one we were dealing with in the autumn. But we will be reminded of that very quickly if we try to do too much too soon. And since we are prioritising the reopening of schools, our scope for lifting other restrictions, certainly in the next few weeks, is extremely limited. That's why the changes I have set out today are modest, but they are also important. They will, I hope, help people's health and well-being by enabling group exercise and allowing for a bit more social interaction. And they will also, I hope, let children see more of their friends and exercise and play a bit more normally. And they should, I hope, provide some comfort for faith groups. I expect that further, more substantial changes will be possible in the weeks ahead, and I will set out as much detail as I can about that in next week's statement. And of course, as I've said before, if the data allows us to relax more restrictions more quickly than we have previously indicated, we will not hesitate to do that. I am very well aware of just how difficult continued restrictions are, and I know that they get harder rather than easier to bear as time goes on. I also know, because I very much feel this too, that the progress on vaccination makes us even more impatient to reach the end of this ordeal as quickly as possible. But I am certain, absolutely certain, that easing restrictions too quickly would be a mistake that we would regret. So do take advantage of the relaxations set out today, but please continue to do so within the rules. We must still stay at home except for specific purposes, which from Friday will include limited outdoor socialising and recreation on the basis that I have set out. We must not meet people from other households indoors yet. That is absolutely essential. And we should all follow the facts advice when we are out and about. By doing this, we can continue to look after each other and protect the NHS. And we will all play our part in keeping case numbers down while the vaccinators continue to do their work, children get back to school, and we all take tentative, but I hope very firm steps back to life as we once knew it. So for the moment, please continue to stick with it. Please stay at home to protect the NHS and save lives. Thank you.
Thank you very much, First Minister. I would encourage all members who wish to ask a question to press their request to speak buttons, and I call on Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the First Minister for advance sight of her statement and echo her condolences to the families of those who have lost their lives. And I agree with her about the scenes in Glasgow at the weekend, when so many people have done so much over such a prolonged period of time. To see a tiny minority risk those efforts jeopardises the progress that we have made. And let's be clear, COVID is in retreat, and that is down to the perseverance of the public and the success of the vaccine rollout. And scenes like those at the weekend risks what has been achieved by the actions of all of us. Presiding Officer, as we relax restrictions, the Scottish Conservatives have always urged the First Minister to ensure that children's return to school was an absolute priority. The First Minister has claimed that too, and last week brought forward plans to get her pupils back into the classroom. She said then it was important for well-being as well as for education, and today she has referred to it as very significant steps. Because of the importance she gave it last week, parents who have spent months trying to homeschool and watching their children struggle away from their friends and from face-to-face teaching were expecting a significant change. It has therefore come as a shock to many to discover that when the letter came in, they were looking at something less than billed. Xanthi in Edinburgh says that for her family, it is half a day per week, which she's called clearly ridiculous and a token gesture. Elaine in Aberdeen was devastated to be told that her son will have only 2 3-hour sessions this side of the Easter holiday. Alan in Fife says his daughter gets 1 day per week, but in return will now get no other live teaching time online, which he brands an absolute joke. Pupils and parents were promised to return to the classroom, but from the information they're now getting sent, it's clear that for many, this will amount to only a few hours a week at best. Can the First Minister look those parents in the eye and say that this is the significant progress that she's claimed? And will she look again at these plans in order to increase the actual amount of teaching time that pupils will get?
First Minister.
I will always look parents in the eye and try to explain the difficult challenges that we're trying to balance. And I understand that few groups in society have found this more difficult than parents who have had to juggle childcare with working from home and all the other responsibilities that become are part of everyday life. So I understand how important this is. Let me be very clear. I set out clearly in Parliament last week that from the 15th of March, all primary school children will be back to full-time education in schools. And that is a significant change. And we will also seek to have some in-school learning for secondary school pupils in the period between now and Easter. It is the intention, assuming there is no deterioration in the position, that we will have full return after the Easter holidays. But instead of having some young people in secondary schools with no in-school contact at all, we've decided to try to do that, even if that is on a fairly minimal basis for the period between now and Easter, in order to try to reacquaint them with school, with their friends, and to prioritise their well-being. I don't stand here and say this is perfect, but we need to balance all of this to get schools back and to get schools back in a way that doesn't then set back the progress of the country overall. And in terms of continuing to look at all of this, the Deputy First Minister does that on an ongoing basis with the partners in the Education Recovery Group to make sure we are striking the best balance and the right balance overall. But let me repeat again, the most important objective that we are seeking to fulfil right now is to get all young people back to school full-time after the Easter holidays. In the way that we did last August, that is what we are aiming for. And in terms of secondary school, to prioritise in-school contact between now and Easter for those in the senior phase, to make sure that national qualifications are being given the priority they deserve, but to get all young people in secondary schools with some contact back in school before the Easter holidays.
Thank you. And Anas Sarwar to be followed by Willie Rennie.
I thank the First Minister for advance sight of her statement and join her in sending our condolences to all those who have lost a loved one. The decision to allow more social interactions is very welcome. It's important for people's mental health and well-being, and that is why we also need to make sure that this is our last lockdown. But that will rely on testing, contact tracing and a speedy vaccine programme. Can the First Minister confirm that every contact of the patient with the so-called Brazilian variant, including every passenger on the flight, has been traced, notified and informed of the need to isolate? She mentions the rate of the vaccines. It has dropped dramatically. Can the First Minister confirm when she expects it to reach and remain at the 400,000 doses per week target, something that we're now currently around half at? And I share with her the sadness and anger at the scenes we saw in Glasgow at the weekend, which emphasised the risk that COVID-19 poses to those who continue to work on the front line. Given this and the further phased return of schools next week, will the First Minister agree, alongside the JCVI recommendations, that there should be vaccine prioritisation for frontline workers, including teachers, school staff and police officers?
First Minister.
Firstly, on the new variant, of course, we had three cases previously identified, and all appropriate contact tracing in relation to them has been done. I set out some of the detail of this at the end of last week. There were a small number of passengers on that flight who weren't able to be traced, but there is no indication of any onward community transmission from these cases. Similarly, the case that I've mentioned today is not connected to those three cases, and all appropriate contact tracing is being done. From the manifest data provided for this flight, there were 22 passengers on board plus the cabin crew. Some 11 passengers, including the indexed case, went into managed quarantine. The remaining passengers were exempt from the need to quarantine. However, depending on the nature of their exemption, are likely to have been required to self-isolate at home and take tests on days 2 and 8. And all appropriate steps are being taken to follow up appropriately. Negative test results for both day 2 and 8 were recorded for 13 individuals, and the National Contact Tracing Centre are following up the other 8 passengers as well. So we will continue to make sure that everything appropriate there has been done. The most important thing to stress at this stage is there is no indication of onward community transmission of this variant, and that's what we need to work hard to continue to ensure. In terms of vaccination, I set out very clearly and very openly the issues around supply. We can only vaccinate as fast as we have supplies to vaccinate with. I have flagged up in advance that we were expecting a dip in supply, and indeed that materialised, and that is why we have seen a dip in the daily vaccination rate over the past period. If you look at the figures for other parts of the UK, you can see the same pattern reflected there. We are expecting now those supplies to pick up again from the middle of March, which will then allow us to work towards achieving that target of 400,000 vaccinations a week, and of course that overall target of completing the JCVI priority list by mid-April. That's priority groups 1 to 9, which, just to repeat, is the majority of the adult population. It's everybody over 50, all unpaid carers, all adults with an underlying health condition. And then of course we will move into the rest of the population. As we do that, we will follow JCVI advice. Their advice is that both in terms of clinical risk, but also in terms of the ability to work through this as quickly as possible, we should continue to prioritise by age cohort. And we will follow that advice, as we have always done with JCVI advice. Many teachers, many people in other key professional groups will already have been vaccinated as part of the priority group so far. And of course, they will progressively be done as we work down the age groups. If we were to depart from that JCVI advice, I think we would rightly stand accused of making political decisions in place of clinical decisions. And we're dealing with something as important and as sensitive as this. I don't think, while I understand the calls that are being made, I don't think that would be the right thing to do.
Thank you. Willie Rennie to be followed by Patrick Harvey.
The breach by Rangers fans at the weekend was the biggest gathering this country has seen for months. And the chief medical officer said yesterday that it could result in an increase of the spread of the virus. But the First Minister makes no direct reference to that in her statement today, and is bringing forward the relaxation of the rules. So does that mean that the First Minister is now confident there won't be an increase in cases in Glasgow as a result of the weekend? Is she confident there won't be an outbreak in Glasgow?
First Minister.
If I was to stand here and say yes, then I think people would realise that I wasn't basing that on anything. I said at the weekend that I was concerned that what happened in Glasgow could set back our progress. I fervently hope that won't be the case. But as we know with this virus, it will be some time before we know that for sure. And of course, our test and protect teams, our contact tracing, all of the other steps that we take, will be working very hard to ensure that any cases that do arise from that gathering at the weekend or those gatherings at the weekend are properly contained. But we've made the judgment, and as with all of these judgments, we've done it on the basis of clinical advice, that given the relatively minor nature of the changes that we are setting out today, given that they are focused very much on outdoor activity, it would be wrong at this stage to hold them back because of the behaviour of an irresponsible minority. But with all of this, we monitor on an ongoing basis. We are still monitoring closely the impact of getting schools back. It's why we have to get schools back cautiously and in a phased way. And it all comes back to personal responsibility. If all of us, desperate though we all are to do much more that we value doing in life, if we all take care to do that within the rules, then we can make sure that this journey out of lockdown takes no longer than it has to and absolutely carries on with forward trajectory. But make no mistake, having crowds of people risks the spread of this virus. And that's why I say again, and I take no pleasure in saying this, people who gather in George Square or anywhere else in big crowds of people are putting their own health at risk, but they are also putting the risk of the health of their loved ones and the wider community at risk. And that's why I say very, very clearly, and again, I take no pleasure in saying this, that behaviour wasn't just irresponsible, it was deeply selfish behaviour. And when so many people across the country are having to make painful sacrifices, missing funerals of loved ones, not being able to get married, you know, grandparents and grandkids not having seen each other for months, we all have to make sure that we are acting not just out of what we want to do, but out of what the whole country needs all of us to do. So I would appeal again to everybody, let's stick with this. We are so close to getting into a much, much better position. Let's not mess it up by any of us, for whatever reason, whatever circumstances, not sticking to these rules now.
Thank you. Patrick Harvey, to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you. Like everyone else, as we approach this grim anniversary, my thoughts are with those who've lost a loved one and with those whose health is still suffering. And I welcome the gradual releasing of some of the rules on meeting outdoors. We all miss mass gatherings. People miss mass gatherings of all kinds, whether it's music, events, going to the cinema. Some people even miss party conferences. Myself, I'd like nothing better to go to a beer festival, but we don't. And the organisations and businesses that run such events have all had to stop until it's safe. Why should a football club be any different? A football club which, let's be honest, seriously did nothing to prevent dangerous mass gatherings in its name, gatherings which trashed the public realm, risked the safety of frontline workers, as well as posing a public health threat. Surely it's not enough just to appeal to the good sense of those who've shown they don't care. Why are we even contemplating letting this business carry on in the weeks ahead when we know it's likely to generate a repeat of the scenes we saw at the weekend?
First Minister.
I was just trying to work out there whether the beer festival and Green Party conference were distinct events or one and the same. Patrick Harvey, I think, makes really important points. Everybody is missing something right now. Many of us are missing many different things, mass gatherings, or just simple ability to go and see loved ones. And it is really, really hard. It's heartbreaking and gets more so with every day that passes right now. And, you know, I understand why for any football team winning the league, particularly after a long period of time, is a big occasion. I get that. But people are being asked to forego all sorts of things right now. And there can be no exceptions if we are, frankly, to get through this next phase as quickly as we want to and as safely as all of us want to. I have made very clear, Deputy First Minister did it yesterday, the Justice Secretary has done it again today. I think Rangers Football Club could have done more to help avoid this happening, just as I thought Celtic Football Club should have made different decisions about certain things they did earlier in the year. I am not partisan. Half of Glasgow think I'm partisan in one direction, the other half think it's in the other. I'm not at all. I don't care about the colour of the shirt. I care about the safety of the citizens of Glasgow. And indeed, I care about the safety of people across Scotland. Rangers, I've had a three-page letter from Rangers, which, you know, doesn't even just reflect the fact that what happened at the weekend was deeply regrettable and that we all have to reflect on how we avoid that happening in future. At no point, unless I missed it, in which case I will have it pointed out to me and I will stand corrected, at no point did Rangers simply and unequivocally say to their fans, stay at home, or when they were gathering, say, go home. So these are things all of us have to take responsibility for. I take responsibility for reflecting on whether the government could have done more, and I know the Chief Constable will be doing the same with the police. We all have a responsibility to get the country through this. In terms of future fixtures, you know, I said in my opening remarks that there are a variety of discussions happening over the course of this week, including one between myself and the Chief Constable later today. We will report back on those in due course, certainly before the scheduled Old Firm match on the 21st of March. The reason we've tried to keep football and elite sport generally going is not for the benefit really of the elite sports people, but for the fans. You know, everybody's been deprived of so much right now that the ability to watch a football match and cheer on your team on the television should be something that people have the ability to do. But a minority can't be allowed to act irresponsibly. So I hope we don't have to spoil that for the majority, but we will have to assure ourselves that there will be no repeat of the kind of scenes we saw at the weekend. And that, frankly, is still very much work in progress.
Thank you. Christine Graham to be followed by Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, we all welcome the phased return of pupils to school. However, in your statement, it is acknowledged that steps being taken to get pupils back may well lead to the R number being pushed above one. Would this impact on the timetable for return to full-time education? And if so, would any changes be national or could they be varied according to the R number either in a health board or a local authority area?
Firstly, what I said is the case that every change we make right now, there is no change we make coming out of lockdown that has a neutral effect. Every change as we ease up potentially increases the risk of transmission. What we have to do is behave in a way that minimises that, which is why when we had the first phase of school return, I said openly to parents, don't use that as an excuse to interact with other adults more than you are already. So if we limit these changes to what the purpose of them is, then we can reduce that risk. And while it is possible that the changes we're making right now will take R above one, it is not inevitable and we'll be working really hard to try to avoid that happening. In terms of if the virus starts to run out of control again, which I hope it won't, of course we would then have to review the pace of coming out of lockdown, and we will do that appropriately, whether that's national or local, depending on the circumstances we face. It becomes much more difficult to accurately assess the R number on a regional basis for, you know, methodological reasons. So we want to, at this stage, focus on having these changes happen in a way that stops the R number going above one. And that is, so the outdoor changes, these are the least risky and they hopefully will not have that impact if everybody enjoys them but stays within the rules. And that really is the message on all of this. If we all stay within the rules, even as we come out of lockdown, then we increase our chances of doing this safely, sustainably, without suffering setbacks along the way. But with an infectious virus, there's no guarantees. We just all have to stick with it and show the discipline that is required.
Maurice Golden, followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Hospitality is one of the hardest hit sectors in our economy. Will the First Minister listen to the Scottish Hospitality and Licensed Leisure Sector's proposals for reopening? And will the First Minister publish the evidence on the impact on coronavirus transmissions of restrictions within the sector?
First Minister.
I'll listen to the representations of all sectors. Hospitality has been hardest hit. The make and have made and will continue to make representations about how they can reopen in a way that is safe but allows them to trade more normally, and we will listen to that. But we have to make sure that any changes we make are not going to risk increasing transmission to the point where it sets us all back, and that is not an easy balance to strike. In terms of the evidence, I come back, you know, to the debates we were having before Christmas, before we went back into lockdown. The evidence can be made to sound really, really complicated here, but it's not. This virus spreads when people come together, and that's why it is places where people come together most and are more likely to interact without social distancing or in places where ventilation is maybe not great. And unfortunately, that includes a lot of hospitality premises. But we want to get hospitality open safely as quickly as possible, just as we do the rest of the economy.
Thank you. Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, in my constituency, luxury specialist food and drink shops rely on the passing tourist trade not just to thrive but survive. This all but vanished during lockdown, and North Ayrshire Council has denied grants vital to such business survival, saying that Scottish Government guidance deems specialist food and drink retailers essential and therefore not required to close. However, other local authorities have taken a completely different view of this guidance. So can the First Minister clarify if luxury food and drink specialist shops are essential, or can they close and therefore access the vital grants they need to survive?
First Minister.
Well, all of these restrictions are really challenging for businesses. As the legislation allows for shops that sell food and drink to be able to open, but not the types of food and drink, it may be that some specialist shops are not experiencing the same footfall as they were before COVID. So the Local Authority Discretionary Fund, which the Scottish Government is supporting through £120 million of funding, was set up to help local authorities respond to local economic pressures in their areas. And I would encourage any businesses in that category to contact their local authority on this.
Thank you, Jackie Bailey, to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Two concerns have been raised with me in recent days. Firstly, the 60-year-olds in my constituency haven't been called forward for a vaccination appointment, whilst 50-year-olds have, and it's of course the same local authority and the same health board area. But secondly, and worryingly, a large number of people have missed their vaccination appointments, 70 people in one local centre in one day. And given the high rates of uptake, this does seem slightly strange. There were issues last year in the flu vaccination programme when people were notified too late, in some areas after the date of the appointment. So could I ask the First Minister to investigate to what extent this is an issue with the vaccination programme and ensure that people are notified in adequate time?
First Minister.
If Jackie Bailey wants to send me particular examples of that, of course I will look into that, since I gave an open invitation to people to email me directly on vaccination issues, then I can assure Jackie Bailey that many, many people are, and that option of course remains open. But the most important source of help and advice in these situations is the helpline, which I would encourage people to contact. On the issue about people 50 or over being called before people 60 or over. Of course, if somebody in the 50 to 55 age group has been called right now, it is likely to be because they've got an underlying health condition and they have the same priority right now as people in the 60 to 64 year old age group. And both of those groups are in progress in terms of the vaccination. Nobody's going to be missed. Everybody is going to be reached. By mid-April, everybody over the age of 50, which includes myself, will, unfortunately, I still struggle to come to terms with that, but will have been vaccinated, as every adult with an underlying health condition. That is the vast majority of the adult population, and then as quickly as possible, we'll get to the rest of the adult population.
Thank you. Claire Adamson, to be followed by Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, I've been contacted by residents in Motherwell, Wishaw, with concerns about the lack of public transport to the Ravenscraig Mass Vaccination Centre. Indeed, it's something I raised with the Health Board a couple of weeks ago. Can I ask the First Minister what support has been given and provided by NHS Lanarkshire to facilitate transport and support those who may have difficulty accessing the centre?
First Minister.
Well, I've also had a number of emails on this issue in the last few days, so we've picked this issue up with Lanarkshire. The board is expanding its communications plan over the coming days to ensure that residents in Lanarkshire are aware of the rebooking options that are available to them. They're also currently working with Strathclyde Passenger Transport on improving transport connections with Ravenscraig. We recognise that not all vaccine slots are going to be suitable, which is why it is important that there is that option to reschedule appointments to a location closer to home or for a different time, if that is more convenient.
Jamie Green, to be followed by Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Further to the various exchanges on schools, can I ask for clear confirmation that to facilitate the First Minister's promise of a meaningful full-time return to all school pupils after Easter, the guidance on social distancing in the classroom will also be altered to enable it to happen?
First Minister.
In order to get all young people back to school, then of course we have to make sure that the restrictions that are required are proportionate, and that includes social distancing. But these are the issues that we continue to take advice from our expert advisory subgroup on. We did, and people should remember this, we got schools successfully back full time in August, and it wasn't school return that then sent us back into a deteriorating position and back into lockdown. So we know we can get schools back successfully, and that's what we're focused on doing again.
Bob Doris to be followed by Daniel Johnson.
Presiding officer, it's been welcome that dates for easing some restrictions have been brought forward, and I particularly welcome the return of congregational worship in time for religious festivals such as Holy Week. But can I ask the First Minister, if the data continues to go in the right direction, could we see even more dates being brought forward? For instance, First Minister, with gyms reopening sooner than anticipated, perhaps in level 4, something I know my constituents would greatly value, as we'd all like to see more things go back to normal as soon as possible, but of course, as soon as it's safe to do so.
First Minister.
In general, yes, as the data allows and as our confidence increases that we can ease up without risking greater transmission, the vaccine rollout has a big part to play in that, then we will accelerate exit from lockdown if we possibly can. And in fact, what we've announced today is an acceleration beyond what we anticipated just a couple of weeks ago. I don't want to give people false assurances. We will set out next week a firmer indicative timetable for further moves out of lockdown, including the reopening of the economy, and gyms and hairdressers, shops, hospitality will be included in that. Certainly, I recognise the importance of gyms to people's physical and mental health, and I think that's reflected in the opening up of outdoor group exercise for adults today. So these things all really matter, and we want to get them done as quickly as possible. But as I keep saying, we will all regret it if we decide to run before we can walk and end up having to go back the way. So let's, frustrating and difficult though it is, let's keep with a slow, careful, cautious but steady pathway forward. And I think we'll find that we get to the end destination a lot more quickly than would otherwise be the case.
Thank you. Daniel Johnson to be followed by Annabel Ewing.
NHS Lothian and the City of Edinburgh Council in particular continue to have amongst the lowest rates of vaccination in the country at 33.4% and 30.1% respectively, in comparison to the 40% figure that the First Minister quoted in her statement. It's several weeks since I first raised this issue in Edinburgh and the Lothian. So can I ask First Minister what steps she is taking to identifying this continuing lag in Edinburgh and the Lothians, or indeed whether she has any insights on this matter? Certainly it's of great importance to my constituents and the citizens of Edinburgh.
First Minister.
Well, when I give average figures in the chamber, by definition, some health boards will be above that, some will be below that. All health boards are progressing with vaccination better and more quickly than we would have dared hope for back at the start of the year. So I think it's really important to give that context. I will ask NHS Lothian to engage with the member. I'm sure he's already in touch with them to set out whether they have any particular issues that they are dealing with. But all health boards are moving forward well and quickly with this, and all health boards are working to the same targets of having offered the first dose to everybody in the JCVI priority groups by mid-April, and of course then having given first doses to the whole adult population by the end of July. These are both target dates that are earlier than we anticipated at the start of the year. So I think it's really important to keep hold of that context.
Annabel Ewing to be followed by Annie Wills.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My Cowdenbeath constituents and indeed people across Scotland will be keen to better understand what may lie ahead in the months to come. So could the First Minister provide some information at least as to what the new criteria will be for the strategic framework levels approach, and also advise as to the planned frequency of the review of the levels decisions going forward? Thank you.
First Minister.
Well, I'll say more about this next week, and I don't want to get ahead of the decisions that we will take that will inform the statement I make next week, but when I made the statement two or three weeks ago, I set out the intention to realign some of the indicators we were using previously to inform decision making to be more in line with the current WHO guidance to ensure that as we do open up, we have confidence that we're continuing to suppress the virus. We will review all of this on an ongoing basis, probably three weekly rather than weekly. And although we will have the ability to apply, should it be appropriate, different levels of restriction to different levels of the country, so that we're not forced into a one-size-fits-all approach in future, it is my hope that we can start to move down levels of restriction as a country, and that we, you know, make that progress overall. And that is why I think it's really important that we continue to stick to the guidance and the rules right now, so that that progress enables the whole country, all being well, to start to come out of lockdown together. As we look further ahead, if we have outbreaks, if we have localised flare-ups that we need to control, then the level system allows us to do that in a much more targeted way than if we simply had a one-size-fits-all approach for the whole country.
Thank you. Annie Wells, to be followed by Joan McAlpine.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, this is a critical time for hospices, with charity shops shut and fundraising events cancelled. Yet only £10 million of the £24 million made available by the UK Government has been passed on to hospices. This is despite promises that all funding would. Can I therefore ask the First Minister, when will this full funding allocation be passed on to hospices?
First Minister.
All of the funding that has been made available for hospices will be passed on to hospices. The balance of that will be confirmed soon. The reason for the delay in that is that we have found it challenging to obtain clarity as to the final consequential figure for hospices. In fact, the Department of Health and Social Care shared information with officials only at the end of February, which indicated that it is now estimated that £24 million has been provided for hospices, but we have not yet still had final confirmation of that from the UK Treasury. But let me be very clear to the hospice sector. Every single penny of consequential funding that comes because of funding decisions for hospices elsewhere will be passed on to hospices here in Scotland.
Thank you. Joan McAlpine, to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you very much. I recently met with the Scottish Wedding Industry Alliance, an industry particularly important to Dumfries and Galloway. While they are grateful for the Scottish Government's support they have received, they ask for guidance on whether they can safely operate this summer. Many already have bookings. However, guidance by the Competitions and Markets Authority means that the cost of cancellation falls on the venue. They also ask that they also point out that weddings of 20 people or less are not viable. So can the government offer guidance? And if it is not safe to reopen, is more support likely to be available?
First Minister.
Well, I hope it will be safe to reopen. As with anything else, we have a difficult balance to strike between economic viability and public safety. And obviously, public safety has to take priority. But we do want to see marriage ceremonies with more guests and wedding receptions happen as soon as possible. And we will facilitate that in line with the public health advice that we have available. And of course, in the meantime, we'll continue to work closely with the Scottish Wedding Industry Alliance about as and when restrictions on ceremonies and receptions can be relaxed. We introduced a specific £25 million fund for the wedding sector. That closed at the end of February. It provided grants of up to £25,000 to businesses and self-employed people who operate in this sector, and we will set out more detail on future business support later this month. But our focus now, as far as we possibly can and as quickly as we possibly can, is to get businesses trading again. But that requires all of us to continue to play our part in suppressing the virus.
Thank you. Liam MacArthur, to be followed by Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, I've been contacted by a constituent whose parents are in a care home in Orkney. She and her brother have had weekly indoor visits and been told outdoor visits for up to six people from two households would start this month. When my constituent asked if her daughter and granddaughter could visit, they were told no, as they were from a third household. My parents feel imprisoned, said my constituent, who adds, all they want is to see their grandchildren before passing away, and they are losing the will to live because of these rules. First Minister, why in a community with such a low prevalence of COVID can visits like this not be permitted? And when does she expect further relaxation of rules so that care home residents in Orkney who are desperate to see their family members can have that contact?
First Minister.
Well, nobody, absolutely nobody, wants to keep families apart for any longer than is necessary, and certainly we don't want to do that for no reason. I'm happy if Liam McArthur wants to send me details of the constituents to ask the local health board to respond directly on the particular circumstances, and I understand absolutely the stress and the anxiety and the distress that is caused in these situations. The one point I would make, of course, and it is a general point, is that it has always been the case under the very difficult restrictions that have applied to care home visiting that end-of-life visiting has been allowed, as has certain other visiting in exceptional circumstances, which can and has included distress on the part of residents. So there may already be a conversation that should be had with the local health board and indeed the care home provider about whether or not that can be facilitated.
Thank you. Alistair Allen to be followed by Oliver Mundell.
Thank you. The Western Isles has reached a significant milestone last week, with more than half of the adult population having had their first vaccination. NHS Western Isles staff and all who've helped them have done a fantastic job. We're also, however, in the midst of two significant outbreaks locally. All bus services were suspended in Lewis and Harris on Saturday, and there was some disruption to the Stornoway Allpool ferry due to a positive test. So can I ask the First Minister what steps are being taken to ensure the safety of key transport workers in similar situations around the country?
Well, there are and should continue to be a range of mitigations in place on public transport, and it's very important that those are robustly applied and monitored. In terms of vaccination, once we've offered vaccination to the priority groups 1 to 9, we will then continue to follow JCVI advice by inviting adults under 50 to come forward in each age cohorts. That's supported by evidence that the risk of hospitalisation and critical care admission with COVID increases with age. So those at highest risk of hospitalisation outside of cohorts 1 to 9 will be those in the 40 to 49 year old age groups. The other point here that I think it is important to make is that this is also the approach to vaccination that will allow us to vaccinate everybody most quickly. Logistically, if we were to take an approach that had to then try to identify people within different professions and occupations, as opposed to identifying people on the basis of age, it would take longer to do that. So we will get through the whole adult population if we do it methodically by age cohort, and we will also have the biggest impact on illness and hospitalisations and death if we do it that way too.
Thank you. Oliver Mundell, to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have had concerns raised with me that vaccination teams in Dumfries and Galloway have been asked to slow down in order to let other areas of Scotland catch up. Can the First Minister confirm if the Scottish Government approved this request, and can she explain why vaccination rates could vary so significantly as to require this?
First Minister.
I am certainly not aware of that, and I'd be astonished if that was the case. I mean, you know, I know there's political divisions between different parties, but what possible interest do I or anybody else in the Scottish Government have in slowing down vaccination in any part of the country? I mean, it really doesn't make any sense. The rate, if there has been a slowing down, which there will have been in the past couple of weeks, if Oliver Mundell has been listening, he will know the answer to that. That has been because supplies have dipped. So that slowdown has happened across the country as supplies increase. In fact, it's happened across the whole UK. As that supply increases again from the middle of this month onwards, the daily rate of vaccination will increase as well. And as I said to Daniel Johnson, I think a moment or two ago, there will be geographic variations, and that will sometimes be geographic. There are parts of the country, of course, that a few weeks ago were hit more than others with severe weather. So there will be some reasons why some parts of the country are slightly above average, some parts are slightly below average, but all parts of the country are ahead of where we, in our wildest dreams, would have hoped to be at this stage. This vaccination programme is going really well in all parts of the country, and we should be thankful to vaccinators across the length and breadth of Scotland for that.
Hugh Stuart McMillan to be followed by Polly McNeill.
The Finance Secretary's recent announcement that hospitality businesses will pay no rates for 12 months, whilst the UK Government only committed to 3 months. Can the First Minister confirm that this SNP Government will honour that commitment to those hospitality and tourism businesses so they'll pay no rates for 12 months?
First Minister.
Yes, I can confirm that, assuming, of course, the Parliament votes for the budget later this afternoon. But the budget will ensure that retail, hospitality, leisure and aviation businesses will pay no rates, at least those businesses in Scotland will pay no rates during 2021-22. That will save ratepayers an estimated £719 million, and it responds to the key request that was made by the business community. In addition to that, of course, we have the lowest poundage in the UK, including an unprecedented reduction in the poundage mid-revaluation, returning it to pre-COVID levels, which will save Scottish businesses over £120 million compared with our previously published plans.
Thank you. Pauline McNeill, to be followed by John Scott.
Further to the question asked by Joan McAlpine, MSPs heard on Friday that 20% of wedding venue owners had suicidal thoughts at the situation that they faced when they were surveyed. The industry outlined they had real concerns that of the thousands of cancellations in the last few weeks. But they did say that the industry could bounce back quickly if they got the right help. Could I ask First Minister, in your discussions with the industry about a recovery plan, could the recovery plan focus on specifically saving those venues from going bust? Because if we don't do that, then the many couples who have cancelled their weddings would not be able to rebook. And I think it's really important for the industry going forward.
First Minister.
Well, that will be a focus of ongoing support in different sectors for as long as that is needed. And I will make sure that is fed into the discussions that are ongoing with the wedding sector. But the most important thing we're trying to do is get businesses back trading. And that includes weddings with wedding receptions. It may be that for a period there are still some limitations on numbers, but we want to try to get back to normality there, just as we do everywhere else, as quickly as possible, obviously for the benefit of the wedding sector, but also for the benefit of all these people across the country who want to get married and haven't been able to do so so far because of COVID.
Thank you. John Scott, to be followed by Neil Findlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, long COVID appears to be an emerging and growing problem, and perhaps the First Minister could tell us how many cases there are in Scotland. Could the First Minister also tell us what measures the Scottish Government put in place to deal with long COVID, both in hospitals and in the community? And will additional financial resources be made available to both health boards and local authorities to support those unfortunate enough to have contracted long COVID if required?
First Minister.
Well, I can't answer definitively. I'll check whether we do have an estimated number of this for this, but I can't answer right now definitively how many people have long COVID, partly because we don't yet fully understand what it is, how it manifests, and how long long COVID turns out to be. The key thing that the Scottish Government is doing, as well as supporting health boards to make sure that there are services available for people presenting with the symptoms that appear to be indicative of long COVID, is investing in a lot of research work to try to better understand what it is, how it affects patients, and therefore what kind of specialisms might be required longer term to deal with it. So this is an extensive programme of work, and one that I expect we will be committed to for some time to come.
Thank you. And Neil Findlay.
West Lothian is consistently behind in vaccination rates, has been from the very beginning. Can I ask the First Minister what additional resources are being put in to try and increase the levels of vaccination in the area?
First Minister.
Well, all health boards have access to the same resources to get on with vaccination. I repeat the answer I've given before. I'm not aware of particular issues in West Lothian. I'll happily ask the Health Secretary to look into that. But all health boards are progressing well with vaccination, and the progress of the vaccination programme is beyond what we anticipated earlier this year. And there is a lot of focus from government, from health boards, local authorities and vaccination teams across the country to make sure that that progress continues.
Thank you very much. And that concludes that item of business. There'll be a short pause before we move on. Short pause.